wanting to give another message there, but all of a sudden this thought came into my heart, which is in connection with the past 2 weeks' message. Turn to Epistle of John, 3rd Epistle of John and verse 2. 3rd Epistle of John and verse 2.
Beloved,
I wish above all things
that thou mayest prosper,
that thou may prosper
and be in health, even as thy soul prospers.
Yeah, even as your soul prospers. Hallelujah. I pray that you may prosper in all things, for his people, that they should prosper in all things, even in health. God wants his people to flourish, no doubt about it. But comparison is, just as your soul prospers, that's a condition. If your soul prospers, yes, definitely, for sure, God will see that you prosper in all things, even in health. So this is the principle of God. I've always been telling you, whatever God speaks, his preachings, teachings, everything, he was preaching to the soul, the inner man, the man given by God. Hallelujah. So, we know that in Genesis 2:7, God breathed his breath into the nostrils of man and man became a living soul. So this, the God given breath, hallelujah, glory to God, entered into the body made with the dust of the earth. Hallelujah, glory to God. That breath of God formed the real man in him. Hallelujah. And again, because since people are listening to this message newly, they should also know, that's why I'm repeating this. All God was speaking, hallelujah, he was speaking to that man given by him. He was speaking about the man given by him. He was always, because that is the spiritual mind of God. He's bothered about the spiritual man given by him to man. So, hallelujah, but people do not possess a spiritual mind, including the service of God. They are having the carnal mind, they leave out the spiritual man, all that they take the word of God. In the Old Testament, most of the things said was literal. But in the New Testament, everything through Jesus Christ is spiritual. But even now, our people take things in the literal way and they use the word of God for the outward man only. Hallelujah. So most of the preachings are going, or most of the preachings are given for the outward man only. Mostly the outward man only is given the preachings in the name of Jesus Christ. If you just search and see, whichever preaching, I'm not here to criticize any preaching, find fault with any preaching, but at the same time we have to find out what is in that preaching, how does the real man given by God benefit out of that preaching. Hallelujah. So if you only look into that, in that angle, then seldom we see that inner man has been given any preaching at all. Hallelujah. So sad today that people do not realize that even preachers, pastors, I should not say, but they are ignorant, they are blind to this truth. So the inner man, the real man given by God is that inner man, and hallelujah, outward man is the secondary, all of, and the spirit man only can join, either the outer man or the outer man or the inner man. But when the inner your soul prospers, you shall prosper in all things. But nowadays if you see, there is prosperity doctrine. Prosperity about the outward man, worldly things. People seek prosperity, blessings of God. But the condition of God is, condition of God through John, the baptist, by God, is that as your soul prospers, you shall prosper in all other things. So the God can bless people, the real blessings of God can be seen only in people who flourish in their soul. hallelujah, glory to God, the soul should prosper. So this is what happened in the Garden of Eden. God said, you shall die if you eat of the fruit. That is, he was talking about the man given by him, that inward man. Hallelujah. But the devil was telling, you will not die. He was telling about, hallelujah, the outward man and the spirit of man given by God, which is going to be ruled over by Satan himself after the fall of man. So he said, you shall live, you are not going to die. So, hallelujah, this is what is happening now. God, through mercies and grace, those who were, we were dead in sins and trespasses, and Ephesians 2, we were saved by His grace. How? Hallelujah, glory to God. The salvation is the inner man coming back to life. That is the salvation. Many people, if you ask what is salvation, they won't. The basic people do not know. So salvation is the old fallen man, dead man coming back to life is the beginning of salvation. And how it happened? Jesus, by God sending His only begotten Son, God who is a spirit, hallelujah, glory to God, sending His only begotten Son, because then now the inner man, the spirit man, spiritual man is dead. And that outward flesh, man in the flesh only is dominated. And the power has been given to the given by the devil. So God, who is a spirit, hallelujah, spiritual being, He had to come in the flesh to defeat the flesh and bring out the soul. Hallelujah. So God, in His mercy, came in the form of man. Hallelujah, glory to God, to lay down His life. And Jesus, He is Jesus, and Jesus was telling that, I have come to give life, life in abundance. So whatever the life of God, when man sinned against God by listening to the lie of the enemy, the life of God departed from him. So the spirit of man, joining together with the outward, by the body, took a partnership with the devil. So, in the eyes of God, the man was considered a dead person. So, only Jesus says, I have come to give life. And what kind of life? Okay, by believing. When we believe that Jesus died for me on the cross to deliver me from the clutches of the devil, that's the gospel. When they believe the gospel, then automatically the dead man can hear only that voice. Hallelujah. How much ever you try to feed the dead man and bring it back to life, it won't come back to life. Hallelujah. The only thing that can bring back the dead man in us, that has become dead through Adam, only through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. By listening to the messages, by listening to the gospel about Jesus Christ's death and resurrection. Hallelujah. Even that, see, it has been commemorated as Good Friday and Easter. Personally, hallelujah, people celebrate the birth of Jesus more than these. So the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, when they start believing in their heart and confessing with their mouth that it is personally taking it, it is for me that God sent His Son, made Him to die for me, shed His blood, resurrected on the third day for me to be delivered and come back to life, delivered from the clutches of the enemy. Hallelujah. If they confess, believe it in heart and confess it with mouth, Romans 10, 9 and 10, then you are saved. Hallelujah. That is the beginning of salvation. Then that voice, that's what Jesus also says in John's Gospel, 5th chapter. He says, the time is coming that all the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God. And now it has come. What is that? All the dead, the people who do not possess the life of God are considered dead in the sight of God. They have listened to the voice of the Son of God. What's the voice of the Son of God? That is the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Who listens to the preaching of the gospel? Now see, the gospel is not preached properly. There are messages about Jesus being compassionate, kind, loving, healer, blesser, and all that. But the main crux of the matter is Jesus died for you. Why? What is your condition without Jesus? People should be taught. Hallelujah. And Jesus died for you, shed his blood. And hallelujah, glory to which you are being delivered from the evil by which, hallelujah, you are escaping from the lost eternity, the hell. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. This only has to be preached again and again. And for which, what should we do? The only thing man is expected to do, the first preaching of Jesus Christ, John the Baptist and apostles, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent is what? What is the meaning of repent? Turn towards God. Turn from everything, from the world, from all the systems. Turn, right about turn towards the God who created heaven and earth, who is the first, one and only true living God. And his plan through Jesus Christ is to get back man to him. So repentance, when man turns his heart towards God and seeking, yes Lord, I believe in your work in and through Jesus Christ, Father God, by sending your son Jesus, making him to die for me on the cross, raised on the third day, who's coming back, I believe it. This gospel only should shine in our hearts. This gospel only, the enemy tries to prevent from people, according to 2 Corinthians 4:4. The word of God says that the God of this age, what does he do? He is preventing people from knowing the gospel, so that for which he has, hallelujah, made their understanding. He has made them blind. He has blinded their understanding, the word of God says. Hallelujah. What is the blindness? Spiritual blindness. He doesn't want them to know about, he may accommodate people to know about Jesus, loving God, loving Savior or healer, as I told you, so many other attributes of Jesus Christ. But he doesn't want you and me and people to know about, oh hallelujah, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ and the impact, if you only believe on that, that you would have in your inner man. Hallelujah. That part that is the enemy doesn't want you to know, and that part he makes people's eyes blinded, eyes of understanding blinded. So this is what has to be preached again and again and again and again to people, for them to come to the understanding. Hallelujah. For the spiritual blindness to leave them. And when the understanding comes and they receive the gospel, automatically the inner man comes back to life. Hallelujah. This is just an introduction. But as your soul prospers, for our soul to prosper, this man, inner man, has come back to life. Jesus says, I have come to give life, and that is not sufficient, life in abundance, that is eternal life. So this life given by Jesus Christ to the inner man, as God gave the life to the first Adam, the second Adam, Jesus gave life to the second Adam, Jesus Christ, and also 1 Corinthians 15:45 says, the second Adam, the life-giving spirit, the spirit of God. The spirit of God, the power of God only can quicken and keep giving life to the soul. Hallelujah. Until when? Until it reaches the kingdom of God to inherit the eternal life. See how much this inner man has to work hard. Be in good partnership, relationship with the Holy Spirit, for the Holy Spirit to keep feeding that inner man with the life of Jesus Christ until it comes into the abundance of life. Hallelujah. But people are receiving little life of Jesus Christ, little salvation, little baptism, little anointing, they are settled. See the subtlety of the enemy. And they remain in bondage. And they don't have the growth in the inner man. Then how do we inherit the eternal life? people make it, the enemy makes gospel very light and easy. It is easy only unless and until we come under the yoke of Jesus Christ. It is not that. Hallelujah, easy. If you are in obedience with Jesus Christ, it's going to be easy. So, as your soul prospers, you shall prosper in all things and be in health. So that's what we are going to see. How do we prosper in our soul? What should we do to prosper in our soul? So the soul man, hallelujah, should be treated with great importance than the outward man. See that everything is opposite to Jesus only is happening in Christianity. Only the outward man is given more importance. The soul man is totally ignored or less, even less importance. Duty sake, prayer, duty sake, attending, duty, attending churches, duty sake, reading, Bible, everything becomes monotonous, duty sake. So, if you read Hebrews, the first thing you see is Hebrews chapter 10 and the last verse. The author says, we are not of those who draw back to perdition. Hallelujah, glory to God. But of those who believe to the saving of the soul. So I told you the initial salvation, being saved, is by believing. The next step is confessing our sins to Jesus, repenting. Hallelujah. The next step is being baptized, you're saved. Hallelujah. And then after that, step by step, there are lots of steps. The final salvation is, as I always used to tell you, Hebrews chapter 9 and the last verse. The Lord appears the second time apart from sin. Hallelujah. For those who wait for Him to give them salvation. Hallelujah. And even 1 Peter, 1st chapter I think was 5 or 6. The salvation that is going to be revealed in the last days. That is when the rapture, when the Lord comes, we will be taken up. That's the final salvation. Matthew's Gospel 24 also we read, He who endures till the end only shall be saved. So salvation, it's not complete. Once saved is not always saved. We are in the process of being saved. So only Apostle Paul exhorts saying that, Philippians 2:12, he says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Hallelujah. So, hallelujah, glory to God. So here we read, we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe believe to the saving of the soul. Praise the Lord, glory to God. Here he says, many people draw back or backslide from Jesus. Why? Because, hallelujah, glory to God, we are people who believe. Which soul can be saved till the end? If you want to be saved, endure till the end and be saved. All that you need is faith on the Lord Jesus Christ. Belief. What sort of belief? Jesus says, when the Son of Man comes, will He find faith on earth? So, every believer will be tested through and through in the faith life. The enemy also will be thoroughly attacking the faith area. He doesn't want anybody to remain in faith. He can allow people to continue to have many things in the name of Jesus. But to remain in faith, people who remain in faith, He cannot tolerate. So all that He wants people to do is, you continue to be a Christian, but renounce the faith on Jesus. What does it mean? We don't put our trust on Jesus for anything and everything. Hallelujah. We are so independent, we are not dependent on Him at all. If I start speaking, if whatever comes, the word of God says, right? Whichever is not of faith, it is sin, it seems. Then that means nobody can survive. So the word of God says faith. All that God expects is, since we are not of this world, we are expected to lean and depend on Him for anything and everything. Otherwise, without our knowledge, we'll be leaning and depending on the life. They have shaken hands with the devil. Okay, that's it. I can't stand the test. I can't stand the trial. They have given room for the enemy. Years back, and the atheist, and they were giving call to people, say, come, join us. You have nothing to lose but your faith on Jesus. Hallelujah. So the enemy doesn't want you to lose anything but your faith on Jesus Christ. Exercising the faith. Exercising the faith in every aspect of our lives. Morning I was speaking about Job, how he was tested. He lost everything in one day. The enemy challenged God, saying that if you have put a hedged fence around him and you are protecting him, so only he is worshipping you. You just remove all the protection from him and give me a chance, I will bombard him. Then see how he blasphemes your name. Then God permits. Given permission, Job was tested through and through. He lost all his belongings, his own children. But he was praising the end of the chapter, if you see. He was glorifying God. God gave it and God gave them and God took it away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Can anyone say that? See, the faith of Job was so strong, he was taking it, whatever evil happened, he was taking it in the right perspective. He was thinking like that, all this was given by God, and he has taken holy sin, and it is taken by God. Blessed be the name of so. That means his heart was not attached on all those things. The light of Satan, that's what I want to say. Hallelujah. Then Satan gets irritated again, goes to the presence of God saying, you have given him good health, he's very strong in his body, so only he's able to bear all the troubles. If you only strike him, hallelujah, with sickness, then see what happens. Then his, whole body full of boils, he's afflicted with. And then his wife looks at him and says, hallelujah, you still want to be, hold on to your integrity? Blaspheme God. This is what the enemy wanted. And now it is being openly spoken through his wife. So she was so weak vessel that he could operate and use her. Hallelujah, glory to God. So say it out loud. Blaspheme God and die. And even then he says, you were talking like a foolish woman. See that way he is saying. Have we not received good from God, and are we not supposed to suffer evil? Hallelujah. In all this, the word of God says, Job did not sin with his lips against God. See the integrity of Job. Hallelujah! This is faith. So, we are not people who perish. We are not of those who draw back to perdition. Many people not willing or not able to withstand the tests and trials and temptations of the devil, they backslide from God. If you only stand in the tests, trials and temptations, the word of God says, hallelujah, that in James chapter 1 and verse 12, 1 verse, if you read, hallelujah, after you are tested and tried and you are approved of God, you will receive the crown of life. Hallelujah. The devil doesn't want you to receive crown of life. So only he wants to disturb and trouble your faith life, saying that see what God did for you. See for them and all he's doing. For you see, you've been forgotten by God. You've been forsaken by God. All negative things make people more intellectual, saying that I'm making them to use their human brain, human understanding, and try to understand God with that. Saying that if God is there, why should this happen? Why that should happen? Why this should? Questioning God and doubting God. All these things, if you only allow human understanding, he will immediately capture that understanding. And he will reveal, give his revelation, the worldly understanding, worldly wisdom, which is against God. Which like a child, and that's what Jesus also says, childlike faith we need to have. Mustard seed-like faith, that's all sufficient. What is a childlike faith? Mustard, whatever happens, I will not doubt God. I will not deny God. I will not go away from God. I will not lose my God. Hallelujah! That is the small, simple faith. Going away from God, that's a simple childlike faith. That's a mustard seed-like faith. Hallelujah! Not going away where? In our spirit, in our mind. We have to cling on to Him, whatever happens. Hallelujah! Never go away, go backslide. Never do that. Backsliding gives room for the enemy to invade our lives. Hallelujah! So God is even in Jeremiah and everywhere we see, in Hosea, He calls out to backsliding people, my backsliding children, come back to me. I will heal your backsliding. What a loving God, loving Heavenly Father we have. He wants to heal the backsliding and get back, get them back to Him, delivering them from the enemy. And by which, if we don't have time, if you read Ezekiel 36, and then even Jeremiah, Ezekiel 11, everywhere the Lord says, I will give you a new, take away the stony heart from you. I will give you a renewed heart. I will give you a renewed spirit. I will put my spirit in it. And I will write the statutes and commandments and make you to walk accordingly. See, who will do it? He will do everything for us. Only thing is, we have to come back to Him wholeheartedly, sincerely. Hallelujah! Saying that you alone, O God, you alone are my heart's desire and I long to worship you. Oh, God wants, if you are in that position, you alone, O God. You also, God, that's the problem of Augustine's. We need you also, and we need this also, that also. God, the word of God plainly says, if you only have God, everything is contained in Him. So, on the enemy, to the maximum, to the maximum, he will test our faith life. But we have to remain faithful to God till the end. The word of God in 1 John 5th chapter, there we read, verse 4. And whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Hallelujah! God is true, and every man alive. Apostle Paul exhorts Timothy, saying that 1 Timothy 6:12, I always used to emphasize on that, give emphasis to that. Saying that, Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life for which you have been called. What is that eternal life? Life in abundance. Never lose that vision. Never lose that understanding. Jesus came just not to give life and the life to come to perfection. That is eternal life. So we have to lay hold on eternal life. The enemy is coming to snatch it away when it is possible. When you lose your faith, you give your eternal life to Him. Hallelujah! So we have to strive, fight. The enemy is fighting against what? Your faith life. So fight the good fight of faith. For what? I will never lose my eternal life. I may afford to lose anything and everything, but not the eternal life. Hallelujah. In Revelations chapter 2, the last verse, and chapter 3, we read, like, lay hold that which has been given unto you, that no one snatch it away from you. What is that? Your salvation, your faith, your eternal life. That's what he is interested in. He's not interested in snatching away our properties or any other skin getting there. Hallelujah. Somehow he wants to bring back the soul to death. So we have to, Apostle Paul did that in 2 Timothy 4, 7. I have fought the good fight. Then run the race and kept my faith. This faith, always, we are strangers and sojourners in this place. So we cannot live on our own. We cannot live on our own. Jesus also says in John's Gospel 15, without me you can do nothing. Because full of warfare in this world, we need always God's assistance and God's help. Hallelujah. Second thing is, for your soul to live, praise the Lord. Isaiah 55 verses 2 and 3. For your soul, secondly, your soul to prosper, what should you do? Listen carefully. Word of God, people take it for granted. They don't, if you only carefully listen, it will go right deep into your soul, man. Hallelujah. If you're going to be, if people carelessly listen to the word, it will just let it go away. We know about parable how, of the sower. The Lord says, it's some seeds fell on the wayside, the enemy plucked, took it and went away. Like that, people carelessly listen, the enemy picks it in. And they forget about the word and sower. Some in the thorny lands, and all the cares of this world, pleasures of this world, and you know, pleasure of money, all this will crush the word. If they are not going to carefully listen to the word. And then third is stony land. It's not prepared, not with a prepared heart. If they don't listen to the word of God without a preparation, prepared heart, just like that casually they listen, the stony heart, they don't prepare the heart to receive the word. The stony heart, it will fall, it will come forth, and then for a while it will be there, since it has not taken the deeper root. The root has not gone deeper. When the trials come, they go backslide. The word of God says, Luke's Gospel 8 and Mark's Gospel, Matthew's Gospel 13 and all you read. So, the seed that is sown in the good land, prepared land, hallelujah, what is that? Receive it and keep it. Preserve it. Really give importance, like, you know, like a treasure. You have to treasure it in your spirit, the word of God. Just like that, you cannot throw it away. Many people, one message after another message, no. One message, apply it, keep it, keep reminding you about it, until it is saturated with your inner man. Hallelujah, because it is the food. But for, I always used to say, for the body we eat through our mouth, but for the soul we eat through our ears. Hearken and eat that which is good. Even that we have to be very careful. Eat what? What is good. Don't eat what is not good. Don't eat junk foods. All teachings. Will again, it will harm your soul. So eat what is good. Sound teachings. I always used to tell 2 Timothy 4, 3 and 4. Having itching ears, hallelujah, they heap up to themselves preachers according to their desires, not willing to give heed to sound teachings. They turn away to fables from the truth. Come to me.
Hear and your soul shall live.
Hear and your soul shall live.
And I will make an everlasting covenant with you.
Hear. The more you hear sound teachings, the more you hear, when even not only through my ears but through mind, the more you meditate, hallelujah, the more you meditate on the word of God, the more you hear the voice of God into your soul. Gospel 8:18. Please read it again.
Take heed therefore how you hear.
Yes, take heed therefore how you hear. For we read, since because they have not heard it with faith, the words that they have heard did not bring any fruit in their lives. You can go home and read it. So, how we hear the word of God is very, very important. With reverence. Jesus, God also says in Isaiah 66:1-2, we read, Him who I will look upon, who? He who trembles at my word. So the word of God, we take it for granted. It is the word of the Almighty God. It is not ordinary word or any other human being's word. It's not any pastor, servants of God's word. But it's a word of the Almighty God. How much we have to have reverence for that. Hallelujah. So we have to train up our, educate our inner man, the soul man, about all these things. He was tempted by the tempter during his fasting. How did he overcome him? Through the word. The enemy says, make all the stones into bread because you are fasting, you know, he provokes the flesh. He's speaking to the outward man only. But Jesus was strengthened during the fasting in the inner man. So he says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from out of the mouth of God, it is written. So every word that is proceeds out of the mouth of God, the man shall live. Jesus always speaking to the spiritual man, speaking about the spiritual man. The devil was speaking about the outward man. Hallelujah! So Jesus defeated him. And Jesus also says in Matthew's Gospel, Him, I will show you, him who listens to the word and keep my word, hallelujah, he will be like a man who built his house upon the what? Hilltop. Hallelujah. It will not be moved, it will stand firm. But he who builds, he who does not listen to my word and keep my word, he is like a man, foolish man, building his house upon the sand. It will be demolished. It will be utterly be destroyed. People, that's how many people are like, building their house upon the sand or the world, upon the worldly things, not according to the word of God. That's why they don't stay long in the Lord. They wither away. So the soul, for it to prosper, for the soul to live, the word of God is important. Hallelujah. And quickly, 19:2.
Also that the soul be without knowledge.
And also that the soul without knowledge.
It is not good.
It is not good. Hallelujah. What does the soul need? Also it is not good for a soul to be without knowledge. The soul needs knowledge. The soul needs knowledge. But what knowledge is given more important preference? The worldly knowledge. Worldly knowledge. Nothing wrong in having worldly knowledge. Study, 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 day and night, study, study, study. Two doctorates and PhDs, postdoctorates, this and that, but still the soul lacks knowledge. They have head knowledge, worldly knowledge. Hallelujah. They increase in that knowledge. Knowledge increases day by day, worldly knowledge. Even about that, the Ecclesiastes in Ecclesiastes 12:12.
And further, by this my son, be admonished of making books.
Yeah, be admonished by making books.
There is no end.
There is no end.
And much study.
Much study.
Is the weariness of the flesh.
Is the weariness of the flesh. They study, study, study. They are so withered. What is the conclusion? The next verse he says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. The only thing you need is fear God and keep His commandments. For this is man's all. Hallelujah. Fear God and keep His commandments. This is the conclusion. The only thing is, oh, so many preachings, all that man's all is fear God and keep His commandments. That is all, and that is what is not at all kept by man. See, people educate children. Fear of the Lord, you know, is the beginning of knowledge. What knowledge? For to study the worldly knowledge. Nothing wrong. Okay, if they fear God, give import preeminence to God, automatically they excel in worldly studies also. When they have to excel in the knowledge of God. Isaiah chapter 5 and verse 13 and 14. Quick reading.
Therefore my people are gone into captivity.
Yeah. Therefore my people have gone into captivity.
Because they have no knowledge.
Because why they have gone into captivity? Because they have no knowledge. See, listen carefully. If people may, even if they think wrong, I am not bothered. But almost many of the people, Christians, are ignorant because of their ignorance of the truth of God, word of God. They are still in captivity of the enemy. They are still in bondage. They are still not up to the mark. They are there means we are also, and we are, since God is revealing it, we are striving towards. Hallelujah. The goal. Nobody is perfect. We are striving towards perfection through the help of the Holy Spirit. Honorable men are famished and the multitude dried up with thirst. See? Without the word of, therefore sure the hell has enlarged itself and opened its mouth beyond measure. They're gone, who? My people gone into captivity. And where do they end up? The lack of knowledge in Sheol. Because they don't have the knowledge, they are blind, ignorant, the enemy takes them captive again. Born again, becoming not dead again, becoming captive again. The more they are not delivering themselves from the enemy by knowing the truth, they go into captivity more and more, believing the lies of the enemy, deceptions of the enemy in the form of godliness, Christianity. What is the condition of the soul? They don't look into it. So, my people are taken captive. That's why Sheol has opened his mouth beyond its measure. The glory and the multitude and the pomp, he who is jubilant shall descend into it. And even in Jeremiah chapter, praise the Lord, glory to God, chapter 4 and verse 22. The Lord says, my people are foolish, they have known me, they know them, know him. They are silly children, they have no understanding. See, really, the spiritual understanding is different from worldly understanding. They understand God from the worldly perspective. We have to understand God from the spiritual perspective, from the word of God. Hallelujah. So my people are foolish, they have not known me, they are silly children, they have no understanding, they are wise to do evil. They do lots of things according to the world, worldly wisdom, thinking that they are smart. But according to God, it is evil. They think that people are smart by doing, applying worldly wisdom, worldly understanding. So worldly wisdom is foolishness to God and godly wisdom is foolishness to the world. So they are wise to do evil. So whatever, if you apply worldly wisdom, there is evil in it. Hallelujah. If you apply godly wisdom, and there is evil in it, and also it is what? Foolishness in the sight of God. That's what the Lord says. My people is what? That my people are foolish. Because they apply worldly wisdom. Worldly knowledge. Godly wisdom is just the opposite of worldly wisdom. Hallelujah. For example, God, worldly wisdom is what? Resist the evil. Lord would say, this is not the evil. Hallelujah. And worldly wisdom is all to you if people speak well of you. And for example, we're saying Luke's Gospel 6th chapter. And the Lord says, oh hallelujah, rejoice when people speak ill of you. What do the people prefer? Christians? People speaking well of us. We do not want anybody speaking ill of us. We get offended, we murmur, grumble, develop hatred and bitterness against them. Because they speak ill about us, my God, we are going against the word of God. Against the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God is we have to greatly rejoice. For great is our reward in heaven. It's not good for a soul to be without knowledge. So, we have to increase. 2 Peter, 3rd chapter, last verse, please read.
But grow in grace.
Yeah, grow in grace.
And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus.
And in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And also Jesus, when he prays to the Father, he says in John's Gospel 17, first few verses we read, Father, what is eternal? It is eternal life. If people know you, have the knowledge of you, that is eternal life. The next point is, Psalm 63 and verse 1. Oh Lord, you are my God. Early will I seek you. What does the soul need? Seeking God. When? First place to God. When? Early. Hallelujah. Early will I seek thee. How? My soul is what? Thirsty for you, Lord. Amen. When the soul really has the thirst for God, and such thirsty soul only can be quenched, that thirst only can be quenched by God. Hallelujah! If you read in Isaiah 44, I will pour out my spirit upon thirsty people. Psalm 107.
For he satisfies the longing soul,
yeah, for
and fills the hungry soul with goodness.
Yeah, he satisfies the what?
Longing
soul and?
And fills the hungry soul with goodness.
And he fills the hungry soul with goodness. See, this is the man of God. It has the thirst, it has the hunger. We are very much interested in feeding the outward man, his thirst and his hunger. Man, the real man given by God has hunger, has thirst. What is that hunger? What can satisfy that hunger and thirst? Only God alone. Hallelujah! And we don't feed this soul man, the real man, so only there's leanness in the soul. Have you ever read about that? There's leanness. Psalm 106:15.
And he gave them their request.
He gave them their request.
But sent leanness into their soul.
But sent leanness into their soul. What was the request? What was the request? The request was for the outward man to eat meat. He gave them the request. They did not request for the manna for the soul. They were requesting for the body, flesh, desire, fleshly desire, God gave it. Then he said, you want outward man to be satisfied? Have it! But you will not, your soul will be, you will have leanness in the soul. Hallelujah! Many people, there is leanness in the soul of Christians. Why? Because they do not have the hunger and thirst. Even if there is hunger and thirst, they starve the soul and they feed the outward man, the flesh. Not eating. I'm talking about feeding. It's not eating food. Nothing wrong in eating food. But next point is about fasting. Feeding is feeding the desires of the flesh. Outward man. Whose dominating the outward man, the enemy again. So we cannot, whatever the outward man demands, we cannot be granting his desires, the flesh and the desires. The word of God says, Galatians 5:25, it is easy to preach. Those who are of Christ have crucified the flesh and the desires and the passions thereof onto the cross. So the flesh, whatever demands, we cannot be satisfying it. It is dangerous. Because the more the flesh gains strength, the more the soul man, it will put down the soul man. So, hallelujah, that's what is the first step. Before coming back to life in the inner man, we were dead in trespasses and sins, Ephesians 2, walking according to our minds and the lust of our flesh, we read. We used to read always. According to the lust of the flesh, according to our mind, we want to fulfill the desires of our flesh and mind before coming to the Lord, before being born again. We were like that. The word of God says, but today's trend, the born-again Christianity says, even after being born again, they walk according to the desire of the flesh and mind, not according to the desire of the inward man for God. Hallelujah. Psalmist David, he had everything, but still, that was the Psalm of David, 63. Psalm 42 says, has the heart, dear, pants for the water brook, so pants my heart for you, God. Hallelujah. Longing for you, God. Am I in heaven but you? I have no other desire, Lord, besides you on the earth. Right? Yes, 73. Psalm 73 and 25. My shepherd, I shall not want. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all throughout my lifetime. I will be in the house of the Lord forever and ever. That is eternal life. Hallelujah. So this is discourage this outward man. Whenever he tries to, overtake the inner man. You're never going to encourage the outward man to overtake the soul man. That is the man given by God. Hallelujah. Discourage that outward man. Crucify that, that's what Apostle Paul said. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless either, but Christ lives in me. Verse 16 says, though my outward man perish, my inward man, you know, it's renewed day by day. Hallelujah. To follow me. Let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Anyone following Christ. Those are the disciples, and disciples were called the Christians. 58, verse 11. The Lord shall satisfy your soul, he will guide you continually in the drought and strengthen your bones, and you will be like a watered garden. What? Your soul shall be flourishing. To whom is he saying this? If you read from verse 1 onwards, you know the Lord is speaking to people about keeping a fast. Fasting is necessary? Yes, it is necessary. Putting that outward man for a time first, and then for a day from 6 to 6, and the whole day, or sometimes 3 days, or 7 days, 21 days, 40 days, as the Lord leads. But don't stop. Doctors criticize like that. It's doctors themselves do not know, I think. I have read an article many times, and there it says for diabetes, fasting is very, very useful. People who fast.
I also read one Philip personality saying, I'm taking fasting.
Fasting is very, very important for, as I told you last week, removing all toxins from us, liquid fasting, juice fasting, because toxins are the cause for many diseases and sicknesses. So fasting is very good for the soul man to thrive. And then 1 Peter 2:11, right? Abstain from fleshly lust which war against the soul, your soul. There is always warring against the soul only. So against faith, against the word of God, if you read, and then against acquiring the knowledge of God. See, for knowledge of God, we Apostle Paul also to acquire the knowledge of God as strangers and pilgrims. That means you are not of this world. Please understand, Christians, that you are not of the world. I am not saying that. Jesus himself has said that. As I am not of this world, you, these are also not of this world, when he prays to the Father in John's Gospel 17. So, Father, I pray that you not to take them out of the world, but to keep them in your name from all evil in this world. Seek the kingdom of God. Seek those things where Christ sits at the right hand of the Father, not the things of the world. Colossians 3, 1 and 2. So, Ezekiel 18, 4 and Ezekiel 20, the soul that sins shall die. Hallelujah. We've been redeemed from the sin, and then the soul lives, which was dead because of sin. If it again continues to sin, it will go back to death. Hallelujah. So, we have to, hallelujah, glory to God. If you want to live sin-free, then you have to be under the dominion of the Holy Spirit of God. And if you are under the grace, sin shall not have dominion over you. But if you get entangled in it and overcome by it, in 2 Peter 3:20, his latter end will be worse than the former end, former life. Hallelujah. The word of God says like that. And Hebrews 10 chapter, there is no more sacrifice. Matthew's Gospel 16:26, he says, what if a man profits the whole world and loses his own soul? Matthew's Gospel 10:28, the Lord says, hallelujah, I assure you whom you should fear. Do not fear the man who would be able to just destroy and kill your body. Do not fear the man who kills your body. But fear God, who can kill your body and cast your soul into hell. Only God we have to fear. I tell you, see the psalmist David, he always speaks to the soul. Psalm 103, Psalm 42, he says, Psalm 103 says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy. What did they not do? They did not glorify him, nor did they give thanks to him, and became futile in their thoughts. And that's why David was so diligent. He was talking to the soul. Oh, my soul. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Says 42, Psalm 42. Why have you cast down my soul? Why are you sorrowful, my soul, and revives his soul? Encouraging his soul. Hallelujah. And first Samuel 30 also, David encouraged himself in the Lord. 38:3. In the day when I cried out, you answered me and made me bold with strength in my soul. When can a Christian be bold and courageous? When you are strong in the soul. Hallelujah. It's not when you are strong in your body, you cannot stand for God. Your body may be fragile and weak, but when your soul is strong, hallelujah, you will be courageous and bold like a lion. So the soul should be strong, powerful. How? What is the strength for the soul? It's the Holy Spirit. Word of God is also strength. But when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you shall receive power. You see, 1 Thessalonians 5:23. May your whole spirit, little for Christ, a little for God, little for this, no, whole spirit, whole soul, whole body be preserved blameless. So that when the soul man is strong, automatically this outward man, the Lord is not going to leave it behind. This outward man also belongs to God. Last week we saw your body is the temple of the living God. So your body, When your body should be kept blameless, your spirit should be kept blameless. Last week I spoke about all that you can reach. You should rule over. Hallelujah, the body and spirit. So all the whole are blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's our responsibility. And God is also faithful. He will also do it. Help us to do it. Hallelujah.